Herzlich willkommen zu unserer heutigen
Welcome to our panel discussion today. We have a big round commented by Martin Fröhlich. Mobility is becoming increasingly more digital. So just booking things, for example, where am I in Berlin right now? There are so many different mobility services. I can book them, and then traveling in itself. I know that with all premium car types, you can opt for half autonomous driving. So I think it's really impressive, almost spooky, that you can just take your hands off the steering wheel when you're doing 150 on the motorway. And I personally still have to gain a little bit of confidence before I feel comfortable doing that. But the question is, booking all these things, an experience in the car, how the car drives, how I work car, will this become more digital? Do I even still have to travel? Then we realized in the pandemic, it's okay to just go to a conference digitally as well. I don't have to travel anywhere. I don't have to get on a train, don't have to get on a bus, don't have to take a car. And that's a topic that we're going to talk about with Martin Fröhlich and his panelists, analogous versus digital mobility. Where are we today and what is the future like? I can see that Martin is still looking over his shoulder and I think he's ready. Yes, you're ready. Great. Let's get started. So, welcome to the second panel discussion, day two of the Hypermotion today, and the topic today, just to make sure that you're in the right place, analogous mobility versus digital mobility, or do these things go hand in hand, these two worlds? That's what we want to debate about today, in our round today, but also later on with you, so that we can open the debate later on. You can ask your questions online, and then we will discuss these questions here. So feel free to come closer. There's still some space available here. So I'm looking forward to a very authentic, creative, and emotional round. The Japanese always say that harmony is the key word. Of course, we want to have a discussion, but at the end of the day, we all want to learn something. We want to make a difference together. Looking at mobility in terms of protecting the environment, that's also important to us. So let's start with a brief introductory round so the panelists can do that themselves, because then I can't make any mistakes. So I would like to give the word to your Ines. Maybe you can tell us a little bit of yourself. Hello. Thank you for inviting me. My name is Ines Kavgan-Kagan. I'm a doctor of engineering studies, and I did my PhD in transport planning, and I am an expert for gender and mobility. Oh, right. And I am the head of AEM Institute, and we provide advice to municipalities and businesses concerning diversive, inclusive mobility. Thank you. I heard that you had quite a few messages on your mobile. It actually looked like a long list, so they were all Deutsche Bahn messages, yes. So apparently Deutsche Bahn first told me that I'd managed to get my connecting train first, yes, then not, and then in the end it worked, I'm here. So traveling without stress is the key word here. Well, you look very relaxed. It's wonderful that you're with us. Okay, State Secretary Jens Deutschendorf, perhaps you could I'd like to tell you a little bit about, maybe you'd like to share a little bit of information on yourself. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm happy to be here. My name is Jens Deutschendorf. I'm the State Secretary in the Hess Ministry of Economics, Energy, Transport and Housing. And I'm an engineer for city planning. That's what I learned. I graduated in 2004, and ever since I've worked in several administrations on different levels, always when it comes to mobility, transport. So I'm looking forward to an interesting exchange on this topic. There's so much happening here, and in the state of Hessen, we're doing so much in this field as well. Fantastic. I'm looking forward to that. We'll start in a minute. So lots of women on the panel today. I'm really happy about that, especially when it comes to mobility. That's really important. Lieke, you've been here before. You've come to talk to me before at the boat event, and now you're here at the Hypermotion. Thank you to all of you. Thank you for being here today. Thank you for being so interested in this topic. My name is Lieke Ibenmar. I work at the user-focused innovation and strategy focus, and I co-founded Hello Impact, and I teach at the Macromedia University when it comes to Smart City Design Master. Thank you. Anja.
Ja, schönen guten Tag. Mein Name ist Anja Silvester.
Hello, my name is Anna Silvester. I work for the Interlink GmbH in Berlin, and we are a consulting firm for local public transport, for rail, and we basically do all kinds of things that tie in with this topic apart from design. But then in 2010 and up till 2013, we had the opportunity to deal with a very interesting topic, the Combi bus in the Uckermark. So that was an old retro idea that packages, parcels should also be on local public transport to give new coverage to local public transport. And this idea really got so big that we later founded our subsidiary, our LALOG Foundation, and I am a CEO of that. So all very digital, and I am looking forward to a fantastic debate. Thank you. Great that you're with us. Isabel from Velo Concept, perhaps you could tell us a little bit about yourself and about your and business. So thank you for inviting me, and hello from Berlin as well. My name is Isabel Eberlein, and I'm the managing director of Velo Concept. And as you can hear from the topic, so bikes and active mobility, walking, cycling, that's what we're all about. So what do? We do big festivals, for example, the Velo Frankfurt or the Velo Berlin, that some of you might know, but we also work on conferences, in consultancy. When it comes to effect, that is what we want to do. We want an impact for active mobility, for bikes. We want to create synergy effects between different players, and that's why I'm looking forward to this debate. So you're perfect here at the panel, and we'll talk about analogous mobility now as opposed to digital mobility. How can we strike a balance? So let's get started. What comes to mind for you when you hear this topic? Well, that's this question. When I heard this title, I thought, what does Matti mean with analogous versus digital mobility? That was printed already. Then it was too late. And then I thought about the topic. I thought there are two ways of thinking. So either there's this active aspect of walking and cycling that's mobile, and then digital is anything that supports that, and you use digitalization in the process as well. But I wasn't that happy with that, because even with a car with digital support, if we have that, then we're still basically being transported from A to B. So that was the interplay between active and passive, and then digitization can support this. Then the idea came up, okay, analogous mobility, that is, we are moving, and digital is, we substitute this movement, which is a necessity to just go places in time and space, and we use digital support. So we bring stream things at home from the cinema, or there's our meeting online, or for example, don't go on business trips anymore. And I thought that that made sense. But the versus that really bothered me, because I always think this idea of polarity, and I don't think, can't we just all be friends and do this together and support each other? So analogous and digital, and not pit these things against each other. That's 100% right. So this is supposed to be a debate. So of course we have a polarizing title that we decided on. State Secretary Jens Deutschendorf. Perhaps briefly, to what extent will communication technologies and digital aspects here be disruptive to the analogous world? What do you think? From my point of view, I think that mobility and analogous mobility, that's a basic need for people. This is something that won't be able to substitute it. We want to move, we want to meet. I'd even go as far to say that we have to move. So that is part of being a human being. The change that will happen in different areas. What is the reason to travel? Where does the necessity arise to travel? The forms of transportation will change. They'll have to. The access too. So digitization plays an important role here when it comes to linking these forms of transport. There are different opportunities, and here at this part, there are disruptive things happening, driven by different points. So on the one hand, COVID. We saw that COVID was disruptive. Also when it comes to mobility, we saw that outside. Then climate protection will mean that change is unnecessary, and that disruptive change is necessary, and digitization too. So the new possibility to combine forms of transportation, there are many disruptive things happening there at the moment. If you think about different new paths being linked together, algorithms helping us to optimize our path when it comes to being fast, clean, and then at the end of the day, of course, the hope that I have here that I want to focus on as well, that it will be easier to do without having your own car, that will be a matter of course. That's something I'm really looking forward to, and at the end of the day, we all have to be able to travel quietly and in a clean way. That's what remains. Thank you for your introductory words. Thank you for your statement. So I've done some reading up. There's something I experienced myself firsthand, and probably you have too. Traveling stress-free. I always think it's so easy to have a zombie mode when you're traveling. You're not really traveling in the here and the now, and you feel driven by things, and of course accidents happen. And this stress factor of traveling analogously, that costs us 6 years of our lives. That's why I've moved out to a houseboat, because I thought, well, all the men in the Fröhlich family, they only made it up until the age of 74. They had a stressful life, a good life, but still I want to be a little bit older than Granddad Fröhlich and others out there. So I said life quality is the most important thing. So I will just move out there, and then I can decide myself who I invite to come see me, where I want to travel. And then I always think beforehand, why do I want to go somewhere? And then maybe I'll just stay on my boat. That's a different approach. It's a different point of view. So traveling without stress. Lieke, we had a very interesting conversation, and you had some interesting ideas which you shared. So maybe you can tell us a little bit about what you think about analogous and digital. I think it's so interesting what Jens said just now. Fast, quiet, clean. That's how we want to travel. And of course, our bodies are made of flesh and blood. We want to meet people. We want to get from A to B. But I think that often mobility has so much more to offer. It's an opportunity. We can develop further. And even when you bump into somebody, something good can come from that. I always want to have this human-centric perspective when approaching things. So I don't think the focus should be on being 100% efficient all the time, and then basically accidents happen because you look at your mobile and then you trip over a stone. So what is important is, what do people do? And just to bring this back to analogous versus digital, of course we saw during the pandemic that we can develop further by sitting at home with our laptop. So the reason to leave is something that we can say goodbye to. We can meet digitally. But can the soul really be nourished at the same time? My father always said that the soul travels by horse, and this nourishing your soul, of course, is a quality in mobility that we want to uphold. Ines, I like what you said, analogous and digital. If you want a combination of these things, I think most of us came here from Berlin today, 4 hours by train. And then, of course, you don't nourish your soul for 4 hours. So you sit down, you work, and then you maybe have some preliminary discussions on the train as well. And I ask myself the whole time, cars, people traveling by cars, you see that the people often have telephone conversations while they're in the car on purpose. So this starts with, this is my to-do list, I'll open it, then look at my diary when I'm in the car, or I sit in the car and then I call my secretary and my secretary will connect me and put me through to somebody else and say, this is your telephone list. So why in Germany is it not possible to have telephone conversations on local public transport? That would be a question for you. So, in Hong Kong, when I get out the plane, it's been a while, but still, then under the canal, under the sea, I can talk on the phone anywhere. So why is that not possible? That's something that we have to achieve. Yes, definitely. It's something we're working on. We all have the same experience. In Germany, we aren't really abreast with times. That also annoys me. That's what I can contribute to this. And what I can contribute, I want to contribute, and the focus here, that we need to have stable networks, that is something where we are creating a rollout in Hessen as well, for example, that where there are gaps in the network, that they are bridged. So I work together with the Bundesnetzagentur, for example, and we work together with the grid operators, and we say to them, hey, why are we so backward here? That is just a fact of life. We are backward at the moment, and these are gaps that have to be bridged, because otherwise we can't tap into the full potential that exists in terms of mobility and digitization. So, yeah, we need to look at this program. We need a joint stance here. Just to conclude this, Anja, what is your opinion on that? So you also are in charge of rural logistics, and you also have the outside perspective. So what is important to you here? And why did you even want to come here? And why did you want to be part of the panel?
Well, first of all, it is a very vast subject matter from various perspectives. I keep saying, if you're traveling, you're also experiencing something. It takes place in analog ways. I don't like conferences in trains. I also hate the constant talking and chatting on the mobile phone. I need not listen to each and everything. I don't need this digital behavior everywhere and all the time. But of course, we need to create transparency through digital means too, with a view to economic efficiency, to develop a new business model that has supreme priority. If I think about our business model with various traffic and transport modes, which shall be interlinked with bus, train, various service providers to move around goods, to handle logistics more efficiently, especially in rural areas. And for that, we need digital means to interlink each and everything and to reduce the administrative effort for all. Hence, we create transparency on available capacities, which is a different aspect, also considering economic efficiency. Isabel, what about you? Anything to add? You also co-developed the Velo concept. There's someone from Cargo Bike. Very promising models, all of them. If everything is put on one track, even with areas free of vehicles, how do you think about it? Well, we should not only present analog in terms of active mobility, so let me break a lance for it. As the moderator said at the beginning, if we think about digital autonomy, we think about autonomous driving, the Hyperloop, crazy innovations to move around digitally all the while. So, in my opinion, the greatest innovation is the bicycle, and that is 200 years old. That extended our radius a lot. And when we think about the future of mobility, it needs to be analog and digital, but it also needs accompaniment by legislative framework conditions. Well, if I see the future visions, I have the impression that these are always armored digital networks, which means that kids don't move to school anymore, but are taken there by digital means. So what is the sequence? All of us as pedestrians, we've all walked a little bit from the subway station, from the car, from the railway station, or maybe from the bicycle parking lot. So how can we redesign our traffic and transport that active mobility can be in the foreground and then use the advantages of digitization accordingly? I'm not in favor of mono-modality, always using one car only, all of us. And most of us prefer to use one mobility. And we don't want to decide anew every morning whether to take the scooter, the bicycle or the car, because we are highly individualistic. And through digitality, especially regarding sharing and electrification of various possibilities, my last point, because you mentioned cargo bikes, there we can rethink many new things, because we only need to think about our mobility system, handle it in a disruptive way, all the more so with the climate goals. Well, since 1990, we have reduced by 0.2%, but we should have reduced by 40%. And by digitalization and electrification, we only have created a rebound effect and no reduction. And we don't talk about climate neutrality up to 2030-35, but we have to make up leeway for the blunder we have made in the past, so become more positive, go further. In a climate agreement, climate goals 2030-2050, well, mobility has high priority considering all the emissions which are produced. So what could be the role of politics more strongly so, to make more meaningful contributions? Corona has just shown what is possible with digital means and communication technology. We have understood it. So if you move around outside, being under stress, you rather stay at home, work on the phone, or try about think about other solutions. Well, it has different dimensions. When talking about climate protection and the traffic and transport sector, well, there we still need to do a lot. As I've described, the CO2 emissions have not yet been lowered in transport and traffic. We've just kept the level to cope with growth in all areas, vocational, occupational, journeys, transport, logistics, avoiding that it becomes even more, but we are called upon in regarding many points to achieve something more in traffic and transport. in all transport modes, expansion of electric mobility, a lot is happening on national level. The federal state of Hesse has developed a Hesse strategy for 2035 regarding mobility, involving all the transport modes, individual mobility, electrification. We have a good program which worked very well, charging at the workplace, that is well used in Hesse, in public transport and traffic. We invest record sums to expand the offer, to modernize each and everything regarding transport and logistics. We have developed new examples of that nature, innovation clusters, various propulsion systems, also for trucks, and we'll do more in that regard. We are working on hydrogen. We'll have the largest hydrogen fleet by 2020. We also support the expansion of the filling station infrastructure. We are working on all, but we still need to speed up more in as far as climate protection regards. Then, of course, well, we also need to see that we are almost back on pre-crisis level regarding mobility. There's almost a fresh boom, so things are restarting. We can see that people are using the new possibilities, which we have come to know, but they also want to get out and move again. Absolutely. But then how come the demand for SUVs is increasing in analog traffic? What is that? Are we no longer happy with what we have? That we are healthy, that we have our legs? Why do we need these status things? Everything influencing our mobility behavior and the what the city of the future looks like. Well, there are few alternatives. Of course, there are alternatives. You can see them here, and we know them. About people are creatures of habit, and in very few cities you can establish habits of apart from not using vehicles and cars, because the mobility infrastructure is lacking. Oftentimes you cannot move easily, get stuck in traffic jams. Oftentimes traffic doesn't flow, even if you are moving in a multimodal way, switching from one mode to the other one. The digital infrastructure in the public transport vehicles is missing, and that is something politics could influence strongly. In Berlin, I'm a creature of habit too. Well, I'm going there with GLB, and well, there's a few approaches which have been offered for that matter, many different modes of transport, but you can just sit in an SUV, you are free, you enjoy your heating, you can be on the phone, each and everything, without having to drive. Well, of course, SUVs does not explain each and everything when you say that everything is focusing strongly on vehicles. That does not explain why SUVs have become more and more popular. Well, for an individual, it has advantages. You sit higher up, you have more space around you. It's another feeling of safety and security. Those are some of the factors. These offers are there regarding individual comfort and convenience that is used. And then the impact on society is a trade-off. And, well, society is vague and far away, and we have to get a bit more closer there, make it more tangible for the individuals to explain what kind of a difference SUVs can make. Well, you have made important points. First, confident convenience and also individuality. It's not necessarily the status symbol. That may come in the course of time. At the beginning, it's just the comfort and the emotional feeling of security. And we experience it today in traffic, that as a pedestrian, you don't have a chance anymore against those vehicles, which takes us to the political issues, how to design our cities and where we should prefer which transport modes. And how can we also make attractives, alternatives more attractive, for example, for switching? Sometimes you reach at a station, you know precisely where you go. If you have to rent a bicycle, it's a standardized system, and analog mobility needs to be made more attractive by standardization. In Germany, each station looks different. We still have railway stations, but for each city you can download a different system, a new app.
Well,
that is from a user perspective, that is not making mobility more attractive. That is based on the logic of transporting people. And we can agree on that on the panel. We want to move away from fossil operated individual mobility, which is only possible if we think it and work on it together. Maybe you also have good ideas on that. You cannot lay tracks in a pop-up way, but you can do pedestrians mobility in pop-up modes. But, well, maybe we also need to talk about that with the Deutsche Bahn. Well, let me just highlight the catchword of behavior and habits. We need to change that too, which takes a lot of time. And Corona was a special situation in which many people tried out alternatives, switching to the bicycles. There has been a boom. Bicycle traffic has grown tremendously. People go out and they see how infrastructure has grown in Germany, but not coping with the flow in the right way yet everywhere, which is another important part of the task. We also have created an initiative, Local Mobility, with many local members developing bicycle lanes, and they have enough money available to build these things. That is more difficult to get enough projects and people, for that matter, to develop each and everything. So many things have got going, but a lot still remains to be done, for sure. Let me summarize various aspects and shed light on them. I think we are on the best track to individualize our mobility. In Berlin, we have the Bergkönig, we have clever shuttles and so forth. That produces more and more vehicles, and they need more space. And with digitization, we can book with a booking app here and there and everywhere. So we need not be surprised to be even more stuck in traffic jams. And it's by far too urban for me. Let me break a lance for rural areas, which takes us to the system. Cities and rural areas belong together. We have mobility chains in different ways for persons, but also if you need logistics. So the product of the public transport and traffic does not yet fit, especially in rural areas, trying to reduce the number of vehicles. Some people, some families have 3 or 4 vehicles, also for the kids. Each family member needs a vehicle. How come? Well, if we only have traffic for pupils and students, a luxury group, it's not a problem for everyone. And if the mobility chain doesn't function over 12 to 14 weeks a year, then I just get convenient and I don't tell my boss I cannot commute to you in the holiday season because then the bus doesn't come. So regarding system relevance, be it planning, be it financing, responsibilities, a lot still remains to be done. Also to consider more the means of transport for masses of people, doing away with jams and the like. There a lot still remains to be done. Well, rural traffic, that is a very nice example. Just stop for 12 to 14 weeks a year, then returning to avoidance of mobility, knowing that German companies have just learned that maybe we could work for one day a week from back home, of course, in the framework of the entire system, also involving the taxation system. And if we know that people like Google may work from anywhere over weeks, then something is also going wrong, because there are also smaller units which don't need so much infrastructure. It also involves a lot of paperwork to do away with shortcomings. Well, let me link up there, because we discuss here about mobility. You now mentioned the employers, and we now have to start in terms of source and target places. So you need to find a mobility offer, no matter whether it's in cities or rural areas, because you know you have access to shared mobility, saying, well, I can access hardware, but also something which you can call on demand.
And then there's two other things I'd like to include in the debate. One thing is a definition. How do we define mobility? How do we define traffic? So we all want to be more mobile. We all want to have less traffic. And we want more mobility. But traffic is basically the waste product of mobility. So how can we be mobile better without having more traffic? And then that brings us to a division of mobility. Then the next aspect that I'd like to emphasize is we have seen a shift in behavior in times of COVID. Why? Because there were fewer vehicles and because you then maybe felt safer to try different things out. So there was this window of opportunity. But this window of opportunity is closing because the infrastructure is not befitting of other solutions. So actually we have to have a look at what other cities do. Madrid, Brussels, so they have 30 as a time limit everywhere. They have rededicated paths and roads. So, for example, something that was adapted for buses or cycling paths were created. And I think there is a need here to do more faster if you want to. So, elections soon. We should maybe vote for parties who want that. I wanted to talk about mobility and traffic. You said that that's a waste product. I think that's great because I have a course I teach which is called Mobility for Society, and we talk about mobility and traffic in the first lesson, but we don't say that it's the waste product, but that it's a shift in location. Mobility is what we can imagine, and traffic is a part of mobility, of this implementation. So I think that's great, but the term waste is not something that I like, because being mobile outside, that is not just something that is organized by an intention, but it has its own intention. So maybe you want to go outside, you don't just have to go get from A to B, but the path is the way and the goal. So working mobile is even possible in my ministry, not like Google, but still one day a week. I think it's important to remember time and again that there are obstacles and think about what the obstacles are. So rural mobility, there was a qualitative survey carried out in rural areas talking about young people, and young people 5 kilometers, 6 kilometers, 7 kilometers, they walked through the city because this was considered to be the safer way as opposed to cycling. But then the bus didn't come. And I just think, we're not in a developing country. 6-7 kilometers, having to walk that far, that takes 1 hour. And yeah, young people are supposed to have time for that. But it's too dangerous by a bike. So parents say it's not okay. End of story. I live in Korbach in North Hesse. 25,000 people live in my town. I have 2 10-year-old daughters, and it's not that bad. So I've bought them the ticket for the local public transport. There is a bus there. I mean, it's not ideal, and I do let them go by bike really often, and both of them do that. So that does exist. It is possible. That's wonderful. I'm happy to hear that. And walking is good to basically reflect on yourself and to become in touch with nature. Otherwise, you're always moving forward, but you have to pause sometimes as well, because you can take the wrong turn as well. One point, Lika, I think this is information I got from you. Young people prefer going by bus or walking, because by bike they can't talk at the same time, because the social aspect is missing. And that is something else that we should have in the debate as well. So where can I have conversations at the same time, and it can be easier on foot? But this is something which is used really often for motorized individual transportation as well. So we have a safe space, I'm by myself with the children, and I can have a conversation that I might not be able to have elsewhere. And talking about mobility with children and young people, this aspect of culture is important as well. We live in a country where everything is full of cars, and this has had a cultural impact on us, on how we perceive ourselves as mobility people. So going by foot, that's something that isn't really appreciated enough, because basically it's great to just move yourself, as is the case by bike or with the scooters too. So for these e-scooters, why is there so much happiness involved? Why do people use this? Who uses this? I think we can ask ourselves questions with regard to our culture as well. How can we change our mobility culture? For this, of course, we need different infrastructure, but we also have to be different role models to our children. So that means we need ministers, state secretaries who live and show a different form of mobility, as you do with your children. But all this has to become more normal. So if I watch a German crime, then everybody's truck going by car, nobody uses a different form of mobility. Or the police is really known for just parking on cycling paths. So from a societal point of view, we are a developing country when it comes to really living a new mobility culture. Could I add something here, please? So having confidential conversations in cars, I find that interesting, because there's usually just one person in the car. Well, I'm just reflecting things, you know? Yes, but of course, in the Netherlands, the Queen goes to an exhibition by bike. Somebody I know is one of the managers of a bank, and she could be chauffeured to work, but instead she goes by bike. Nobody is scared of being sweaty when they get to work. So there aren't enough good examples here, and we don't have enough examples of our own. In Hanover, a couple of months ago, there was a mobility week. I don't know whether you've heard about it. And then at least for a couple of days, the policymakers used bikes. So that was their own attempt. And I think that's great, because then you can see how difficult the infrastructure can be, how it can impede people. This curbside, if you can't make it to your goal, if people swear because these few meters by bike that you're in the way, or with the scooter that you're in the way. Just having attempts like that is good. I'd just like to add something, because I love talking about bikes, but I also love talking about other forms of transportation. You can download an app, try some sharing, go and try an e-car, but for that you need courage. For that, you need to have an introduction to this. How can you learn more about this? How can we try that out? So we tried a couple of vehicles just now as well to just feel what it feels like. And I was like, for me, it was too difficult. That's not something I'd want to drive in my everyday life. It's too difficult to steer. So where are places that we can try things out in and so that we can see whether it can be rolled out throughout society? That's great, because in schools in year four, they learn how to ride their bike. And then in Berlin, later on, there are courses on how to behave in buses or in local public transport. So a lot of things that are done are really educational, but it's not about mobility as a sustainable system of different forms of transport that aren't necessarily just about the car. So it's not just about rules, it's not just about security, it's about having a look at how can you show children that they don't basically want to be driven to school in an SUV. I think that's good. So school mobility concepts, if schools focus on this, so basically how do children get to school depending on the modes of transport, where are the risks, where are the dangers? That's something that happens, and I really feel invited as a politician to talk about my own form of transport. I'll tell you about it. So yesterday I drove to work, I cycled to work actually. This morning, first I got on a bus to the Rhein-Main Congress Center, and then I walked to the ministry. So that does happen. But here, I did come here by chauffeur, so everything. You talked about education. Why, when it comes to sustainable mobility, climate change, why can't this be integrated in schools some more instead of just preaching theory? Why can't we focus more on implementation? Why can't we say, my dear teachers, so this was theory, now we have 50% practical lessons, then people can experience everything, and then this mind shift happens where people say, wow, that is much more stress-free. I'm doing something good for my body, for my mind, something beautiful about the school context. Everybody has this goal of getting to school safely. Next week is the Safe to School Week. That's a federal program. And there are three pillars. So on the one hand, educational aspects, then infrastructure, then communication. Getting to school safely for people who basically want to drive their school right to the door of their classroom with an SUV, they are the people who also want to let the children walk to school by themselves. And that's a great area, because this typical thing of car versus something else, that's not the way it works. That's not something I believe in anyway. I think cars are great, to, you know, they're fun when I'm on holiday and so on. But I think we really need to have a harmonious approach here. Following up on that, I want to talk about the Hamburg Traffic Association. They do so much educational work, and lots of things are included in the curriculum. So it's not really enough if the teacher just gives a lesson and says, how do you read a bus plan, or here's the map with the subway information, so how do you deal with it? No, this really has to be a part of the curriculum. But there's another aspect that I'd like to highlight. We basically create a lot of traffic, and that brings me to site location. So looking at rural areas, when new commercial areas are started, then you think about a place to park, but there's not even a bus stop. So when it comes to corporate mobility management, which is something else we're active in, it's important to think about how shift workers can deal with mobility apart from their cars. How can they get to work without their cars? What about the trainees who arrive far too late at work because there is no bus at 6 that drives to where they need to be on time? So basically, there's a concentration strategy of big food retailers or the discounters. We really have long distances to cover, and cargo bikes aren't enough in rural areas. So when it comes to planning, at some point, authorities, when it comes to the topic of mobility, everything has to be offered, and planning without local public transport, that is something where architects have to be involved as well, because they basically do things that are not okay. This last point that you made, I went to Holm the other day, so that's at the new Gateway Gardens train station stop, and everybody said, yeah, great local public transport, we're finished with it, but then you get you out of there and there's a construction site everywhere, so there's no place to walk, and I had to ask the construction workers where I could walk. There's no other mobility apart from the fact that the subway station is now completed, so it's the surroundings, and I agree with you 100%, that has to be taken into account. And how can we plan cities? So these cities were built according to all kinds of different principles. Now we need to have a mixed principle, though. We need short paths. And this brings me back to the original point. Mobility basically is the connecting factor between living, between shopping, between leisure time, between working, all these different activities. The way our cities were built over the last 60 years. So first you drive to Aldi, then you drive to school, pick the kids up, then you go somewhere else, and it's just always one car to another place instead of just leaving my car somewhere and being able to move in a different way. And my last sentence to this point with the children, because, yes, in year four, we talk about cycling permits, but basically we have to make it possible to children to have independent mobility. And in Bavaria, children can't go to school by bike because it's too dangerous, and schools call the parents of the children who turn up at school with their bikes because the parents then have to pick the children up. So that is a problem that we really have to tackle, that we make our cities safer and really think about everybody here. So first of all, I'd like to please let me know what it's like when the construction site is over. Then we'll have another mobility check. You can tell us what the final result is, because of course we think it's great that Gateway Gardens is completed now, because the decision that it was necessary until it was actually constructed and then it was in use, that's something that we were actually quite happy about, and we're looking forward to the application being good too. Then I wanted to talk about population settling development. That's important to us as well. So when it comes to Frankfurt, Bogen, how can we have more living space here in this area, in the Rhine-Main area? Of course, the railway infrastructure was really important for us to see from that point. How can we develop new districts? And our basic condition was to be a part of the Frankfurt Bogen. It has to be possible to get from a subway station to the main station within 30 minutes, and the district, the area, is only allowed to have a maximum distance of 1.5 kilometers to the next railway point. So that was very important to us at that point. And then that, of course, links to inner development and other fields. So basically, this is how this mobility topic is being integrated into the development of new districts as well. And then yesterday in Kelsterbach, we had an important event. So there's a lot happening here with these different concepts, reducing the amount of parking places. Is there something I can add here? I have a brief question. So I think it's great to support mobility concepts, but is that the courage among policymakers to say that these places can be car-free? That's a really interesting debate. That's something which I see on a municipal level. It's something which is being performed in a very courageous way. So in 2019, before I returned to Hessen, I was in Bremen because I was very active in the construction field up there as well. And I think that is the right path. And I think a lot more is possible than you can imagine these days. But there are difficult processes in debates on the ground as well with all those who are used to having people park in front of their shop. So when it comes to reducing parking places, then the debates can become very heated.
Yeah, also
Ich fahre morgen nach Wien.
Well, I go to Vienna today, and they have shown us years ago already
wie man den Anlässen zu
how
mobil zu werden nah an sich holt und diese 15 Minuten
to become more mobile, building this 15 minutes city. Now what did I want to say? I forgot, sorry.
Jetzt habe ich es tatsächlich vergessen.
No, I really forgot. Sorry for that.
Wieder, also zum Thema analog und digital.
Well, coming back to analog and digital.
Das Thema rauszuholen aus dem, was gerade besprochen wurde.
Against the backdrop of what we've just discussed, considering what we have discussed, how to also think the other categories and consider each and everything.
Nicht mehr
well, we said we shouldn't be have to be in traffic every all the time because it can be digital and mobile. Well, the kids, when they go to school, they learn to become more independent and develop self-confidence, make more experience in that sense. And if the possibility is taken by the lockdown, and then much more is lacking than the educational gap. Then this takes us back to the digitization of school content, substitution of routes, then the way becomes the goal. And in that sense, it would be good to think about these things. Well, now I know what I wanted to mention. Well, there are also generations, populations, also populations of vehicles. I mean, it's still there for 15 years after buying it, unless the state would buy them back. But mobility is moving much faster. I mean, digitization is moving much faster. And therefore, it's very exciting to see how to bring these elements together to really reach what we want to reach with mobility, namely the development of new chances and opportunities. So we should upgrade the vehicles in shorter cycles. Is that what you mean? Yeah, but also with the hardware. Well, in mobile phones, it's quick, an update, and then every few months, and then it just takes a few hours. Well, you asked the question with the versus. So we have to decide whether you want to meet something personally, or can we not meet digitally by means of video conferences? Well, we have tried it out for 1.5 years, and we can now assess quite well what functions, on which occasion, what works less. I mean, there are many very innovative projects where we also need our minds and need to take things on new tracks. And for that purpose, we need to work with people and their reactions and a lot of emotions, and the digital means don't help that much in that regard. I also work more with people instead of digital tools, and therefore, well, for a burdensome team meeting, I need not travel over a distance of 50 kilometers to meet my partners. That can be handled in 1 hour's time digitally, to get in touch for this purpose, but to really grasp the value added, the full output, it's nice to be on site and to go into interaction with other people. So we have to weigh these aspects every time, should I do it digitally or in presence. We people have six senses, and the other senses are thirsty in this desert if we only communicate in two ways. That was disturbed my father all the while. Therefore, he invited the kids for a week, and well, I was supposed to be part of that, but before I understood that it's not my brothers and sisters. sisters, but the pupils, the students of my father. And so we need these six senses, otherwise we are too thirsty. So what did we discuss? What does it have to do with digital and analog? We also went away a bit more from the actual topic, which is important, also talking about surfaces where mobility is developed, about schools and housing, and there we also need to create the choice in one's houses and homes, maybe new design of rooms with new office space. In quarters, this should be integrated. What about mobility concepts? I don't need a cargo bike every day, but maybe once a month, maybe if I want to do a party, or if there's anything else. Or maybe on the way to the station, I need a different means of transport than on the way to work. So having the choice, the analog point for this purpose, but also a digital platform where I can find things easily, no matter where I'm, whether I'm in my home place or elsewhere. A space just like a kindergarten. Yeah, that's also a cool idea. Of course, we cannot discuss each and everything in full detail, but you are still around a little bit also for the actors in the audience. There you can go into further discussions and we can hear maybe concluding statements by all of you of 7 seconds to know what you want to pass on to this topic title of analog and digital mobility, please. Well, people in highly active mobility. Digitization is a means to an end, but we need the interaction amongst us people. I come with the low-hanging fruits working in this railway. Well, it's exciting to link up with what we have just discussed, namely what remains from Corona and the push, also regarding digitization, namely getting access to events like this one. You need not present, be present, you can, but you also have digital access, which is an enrichment, an option to create more access. And in the back of my mind, I still have the idea to ask about the digital journey. I can give you a link in a minute. I think we can imagine this, then you lie or sit somewhere and you are just in moving in thoughts in a digital way. Well, digital or analog, not either or, but both together. And we'll think about it depending on the situation. Well, thank you very much for joining us here in the Hypermotion Lab, Hypermotion 2021. I look forward to the continuation of the talk, so also in the following week, also with you digitally outside. I hope a continuation follows shortly. I hope you stay healthy, and thanks for coming. Thank you, Martin. You did a wonderful job. Thanks for the lively discussion. Tomorrow again, the same time, data salad, everything which is collected on the platforms and what could we make of it? How to establish order there for a start? Exciting subject matter for tomorrow. Here we have a 15 minutes break now, the Wish Mobility think tank and the cargo bikes, how to get the loads into the right place with the right means of transport. See you in a minute. Thank you for now.